better than being introduced by the host of Yum's the Word, which should be on the table, which is now its fourth year, right, Robin?
Almost fifth in,
almost
in
fifth
August.
Year.
Yep.
We just had Jason Biggs on, and a slew of other people as well, so this is fantastic. So, speaking of being a mensch, this seriously, I'm sitting here watching everyone come in. I'm like, this is like an intellectual bar mitzvah. Right now. And I'm looking around like, these are people who just want to get down and party with their brains. And that's what's so nice about the storytelling community and the community that's here today. It's full of people who want to hear about other people, who actually want to hear about someone other than themselves, which is a rarity in today's day and age. So this is great. So speaking of being a bar mitzvah, I'm going to tell you something, and I ask you not to judge too fast. That is, for 13 years, I was a bar mitzvah MC. That actually is me up there with one of my dancers at a New Jersey bar mitzvah, and I did that for 13 years. And in addition to that, I did weddings and blah, blah, and all this stuff. But my main thing was bar mitzvahs. And a lot of my colleagues in the industry were like, why do you do that to yourself? Like, stick with weddings. And when I actually, you know, the main reason I got into the DJing in the first place, because here was the interesting thing, is I grew up with a family who didn't know any better, and they let me start a business when I was 13 years old. So while my friends were being bar mitzvahed, I was DJing their bar mitzvahs. And I started it doing it like that. And I was 13 and doing weddings and all of that kind of stuff. And just nobody knew any better to say, you probably shouldn't be doing that right now. But what I liked about it so much, and the reason that I got involved with that whole live entertainment world, was because I loved having the opportunity to create an environment that lowered people's inhibitions. I believe that if you lower people's inhibitions and you just gave them an environment to do something crazy, then maybe they build a little self-awareness. Maybe they grow a little bit more. Maybe they become more self-aware and explore things in life that they didn't on any given day. And even to this day, I produce things that are hopefully going to inspire people, help people grow. It might be through aesthetics. It might be through the dance comp world. How many people are here from StarQuest, as a matter of fact, tonight? Oh, what are you doing? Shows of hands. Look how polite they are. So we've got a bunch of StarQuest people here today. As a matter of fact, we tour around the country and host 35,000 dancers in 65 cities in something like 17 weekends. I'm not a dancer, Jordan. Do not ever take a photo of me. But I do it because I believe in giving people an environment to lower their inhibitions and do something bigger than themselves. And even when I was in high school, I remember that when I was in high school, I was a freshman, it was the first day of school, and because I was this little entrepreneur, you know, a lot of the seniors were already out for me. They were, we're going to go after that kid. And I remember being on the floor at my locker, and a senior walks up to me, and he goes, what are you doing here, Mr. Businessman? And he was like the sports, I don't know, the guy who plays football, the main guy, whatever that is. But he's like, what do you do? And I'm like, I don't know. He's like, well, what's your business? I go, I help build self-awareness and help people grow. And I didn't know any better of an answer at the time. And that didn't go over so well for the little freshman. And I said, love. And he's like, I don't know what that means. I go, I think that people should do what they love in the world. I think they should do things with meaning. And the guy goes, and he literally looks at me like this. I remember the look. He goes, then there would be no garbage men in the world. And I remember, again, being a little freshman, which is, what, 14 years old? Actually, I did fourth grade twice, so I was probably 15. But I remember going, that's very presumptuous of you to say that garbage men aren't doing what they love. And he looked at me like this. Oh, by the way, there's a heavy metal band going on next door at tonight's show. And so what was funny and rewarding for me a few years later, oh, I said, hey, no, if everyone did what they loved and everyone did what they liked, then eventually collecting garbage would become something of great meaning, of great service. And just a few years ago, there's one person here who actually knows who I'm talking about. My best friend from high school, Marisa, had a child, and I was at her house, and the child was playing with a recycling kit, or his toy recycling kit. And I went, how awesome is that? He's actually playing with something that he believes is an awesome job, and it's collecting garbage. And look, the reason that recycling and garbage collection in that term became so popular is because someone said, I need to make this meaningful. I need to make this important. I need to do something that leaves something greater behind at the end of the day than a heap of garbage. And that's what today is about. And that's what this inaugural show is about, which, by the way, for the inaugural show, sold out. Thank you very much for coming, everybody. But the concept of today is this, and that is, imagine a world where everyone did something that had meaning to them. And I hope that everyone here does do something that has meaning to them, or if you don't, that you're about to, and you're gonna embark on that journey. Because time is I obsess about how I use my time. It's like a disease, because we're not here that long. Like, if you actually look at the life, the span of the world, in general, humans have only been here for a sliver, and us in the room right now, we're just like this little flash. And so it is my goal in life, through everything that I do, and my hopes for everybody here in the room, that we do things that have meaning to us, because that is how we will live on forever. And so tonight, I have three people who I feel have great accomplishments in the world, and I don't know exactly how they got there. I had some conversations, but the whole concept is commit first and then just figure it out later. Right? I mean, I think that's sort of the secret formula. And I, you know, for a lot of people who I've met who are very successful, they committed and they just figured it out. This show right here was booked like 3.5 weeks ago, and I had zero people speaking on the panel. And I am so grateful I got the people speaking today that I did. So today is about doing meaningful work, and one of my blogs is about perfection. And so many people are waiting to do the meaningful work. They're waiting to do the meaningful work for the right time, for the right project, for the right burst of inspiration, right? For the right amount of money, for the right partner. And perfection is a fantasy.
Yes.
Right? Amen, right? There we go. Perfection is a fantasy. All you need to do is something that's kick-ass. Do something kick-ass and have it fall on its face like our tech did this right as before we opened the door, and that's fine because you're delivering. So tonight, I want you to keep your phone out. Please turn the ringers off. Tweet if there's something that inspires you, because again, if we can get messages like this out, maybe we can help evolve the world to do more work that's meaningful, and we can enjoy ourselves, these little flashes that we're here, and just enjoy ourselves more. So I'd like to bring up a very special guest here tonight. Everyone's a very special guest that's here tonight, including the guests. You guys. So, the first person I'd like to bring up, I'm going to actually interview her, and then we have two people telling stories and giving presentations about their paths in life. So, my first guest is made her Broadway debut as Ariel in The Little Mermaid. She was Christine in The Phantom of the Opera in the 25th anniversary show. She was in Masterclass, It Could Have Been You, and now she's in a show that I happened to see right before I invited her up here, and that is the leading lady in School of Rock, Sierra Boggess.